Hello and welcome to this Asia Society session in partnership with the Hinrich Foundation. My name is Andy Staples, and I'm the Director of Research and Outreach at the Hinrich Foundation. Delighted that you could join us this evening, and just a couple of notes of housekeeping before we get underway. First and foremost, we welcome your comments and questions, and could I direct you to the Slido a platform for that. And if you go to www.slido.com, that's S-L-I-D-O.com, and the code for this meeting is 0916. And you'll be able to type in your questions there. I'm very keen to get through as many questions as I possibly can. So please do be prolific with your questions and comments to the panel. Let's move on then. We have 1 hour. I'm very much looking forward to this conversation. And our theme this evening is looking at US-China relations. I think one of the biggest issues that we're facing in the global political economy at the moment have been for some time. And of course, things are hotting up as we get closer to the US presidential election as well. Two aspects of the title of this session stand out for me. First and foremost is new Cold War, and secondly is de-risking the US-China conflict. And I think what we'd like to do is, first of all, explore whether we are in a new Cold War, what that means, and secondly, how do we move towards de-risking the very real tensions that we have. And of course, this situation is multifaceted. We're looking at the economic development of China. We're looking at US domestic and foreign policy. We're thinking about trade, technology, security, and all of these issues coming together in this tension that we have between these two core economies, and really setting the scene for the rest of the global political economy at the moment as well. So with those opening remarks, I'm delighted then to welcome our panelists today. We have a fantastic lineup, and first and foremost, Dr. Alan Dupont, one of Australia's best known strategists, Asianists and thought leaders on geopolitical risk, foreign policy, defence and national security. Dr. Dupont is CEO of the geopolitical risk consultancy Cognoscenti, and also a research fellow here at the Hinrich Foundation, and very recently published a paper with the same title, New Cold War, De-Risking the US-China Conflict, which you can find on our website. The profiles of all of our speakers are on the website, so I won't spend too much time going through them, but just to note that Dr. Dupont has been an advisor to many Australian ministers of defence and foreign affairs. He's had a 25-year service in government as an army officer, defense intelligence, and then as an analyst and diplomat, and also a very distinguished academic career as well. So, Alan, delighted to welcome you. Secondly, I'm sure many of you will be familiar with Wendy Cutler, who's Vice President and Managing Director of the Asia Society Policy Institute. More importantly, thinking about our conversations today, had a long career of nearly three decades as a diplomat, negotiator with the Office of the U.S. Trade Representative, most recently served as Acting Deputy U.S. TR, working on a range of U.S. trade negotiations and initiatives in the Asia Pacific, not least the Trans-Pacific Partnership and the U.S.-Korea Free Trade Agreement. Wendy, welcome to you. And finally, I'm delighted to welcome Helen Qiao, who's the Chief Economist for China at Bank America, Merrill Lynch, and has also spent a distinguished career in the financial sector as one of China's leading analysts of that economy. She previously worked for the World Bank, in Washington, D.C., the Lehman Brothers in Tokyo, and has published a wide range of papers on China. Helen, thank you very much for joining us as well. I'm delighted to see such a range of talents for us to explore these questions this evening. So with that, Alan, if I could turn to you and just pose a very straightforward question. What allows you to make the claim that we're in a new Cold War?
Well, first of all, good evening, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here. So I know I have to be brief and succinct, so let me just go to the heart of the paper that I've written for the Hinrich Foundation. So why do I think this is a Cold War? Well, my central thesis in this report for the Hinrich Foundation is that the U.S.-China relationship has moved from a predominantly cooperative framework to one of strategic rivalry. Now, unfortunately, this rivalry has escalated alarmingly, particularly in the last 12 months, and has already taken us into what Henry Kissinger has called the foothills of a new Cold War. If not yet its frigid heights, it's not very good news that someone as distinguished as Henry Kissinger would consider we are in the foothills of a new Cold War. Now, not everybody agrees with this. It's still quite contentious. But I think it's fair to say that sentiment in the last 6 to 12 months has shifted towards the view that there is something like a new Cold War developing, and that is certainly my position. Now, why do I argue that? I think there are six striking parallels to the first Cold War, which you will recall was between the United States and the Soviet Union. The first thing to note is that the US-China rivalry is between the world's two most powerful states. One is a liberal democracy and the other is an avowedly communist state, an authoritarian state. There are clear parallels between the Soviet Union and the United States in that first Cold War. Secondly, the competition between them is a systemic-wide contest for supremacy. It traverses all aspects of their relationship, from trade, from tech, the human rights, virtually every dimension of their bilateral relationship. But it's also systemic in the sense that it's drawing in the rest of the world. And other countries are not going to be able to detach themselves from this contest for supremacy between the United States and China. Thirdly, like the First Cold War, it is about ideology as well as national power. This is an intensely ideological conflict. Fourthly, it is what I call a multi-decade struggle for global ascendancy. This is not something that's going to blow over in the next couple of years. I think we're in this for a long time, and unfortunately, we're at the beginning of it. Fifth, I believe that a second geopolitical bifurcation or division of the world is likely. I think it will not be as rigid as the First Cold War. It will be greater fluidity. Countries will attempt to move from one side to the other. Many countries don't want to have to choose, but I think there's a reasonable chance that there will be a geopolitical division that has parallels with the First Cold War. And sixth and final, although neither side wants a full-scale confrontation, because clearly it would be very damaging for both countries' interests, one cannot be ruled out. In short, it's not your run-of-the-mill great power conflict. Now, in the report that I wrote for Hinrich, I touched on the trade conflict, and I'm sure Helen, I'm sure that my colleagues will want to talk about that after I finished. I've also talked about the tech war, but really the heart of the contest between the US and China is geopolitical. Why do I say that? I think it's rooted in their competing ambitions to be the preeminent state of the 21st century. It's also a reflection of their diametrically opposed values and political systems, and both countries' sense of exceptionalism, which makes it very difficult for them to accommodate each other's differences and interests. It certainly raises the possibility that the Cold War could turn into a hot war. Although on balance, I don't think that will happen. I think it's more likely to be a simmering, essentially contained rivalry between them, characteristic of a Cold War. But a hot war can't be ruled out, and I think the most likely triggers for any military conflict between the US and China would be the South China Sea and particularly Taiwan. So, Andy, I think I might leave it there and over to you. Thank you.
Okay, Alan. Well, thank you very much for sort of surveying the landscape there of this new Cold War. And you mentioned trade a couple of times as one of the triggers or impacting factors in this assessment. And with that, I'd like to bring in Wendy. And Wendy, first and foremost, I guess I should ask you whether you agree with this assessment, with the nomenclature that we are in a new Cold War. And secondly, what role has trade been playing within this conflict, along with all the other issues that Alan was just noting there? And also, if I could pose one further question to you, given all the tensions that we see, particularly in places like the South China Sea and Taiwan and Hong Kong and technology and so on, is actually trade one of the bright spots at the moment? The only reason I say that is because we are having discussions between the two powers, most recently just at the end of last month. So with that, let me pass over to you.
Well, thank you very much. And I'm really honored to join such a distinguished panel. And we're from all over the world. So it's great that we could find a time where we could all convene. And thanks to the Hong Kong Center of the Asia Society for bringing us together. You know, in terms of whether we're in a Cold War or we're on the verge of a Cold War or we're headed to a Cold War, I think we can all debate that. There's no answer, but I think we could all agree that we are in a period where U.S.-China relations are bad and they're getting worse. And frankly, you know, some people say they're in free fall and there's just no floor to how low they can go. And clearly, week by week, day by day, all you need to do is go into media and read actions the U.S. is taking, actions China's taking against the U.S., rhetorical exchanges, barbs being exchanged. And it really is of great concern to the global community. And I couldn't agree more with what Alan said. Even though this is a rivalry between the U.S. and China, it brings everyone in now, given the integrated world that we face. For me, having kind of grown up during a good part of the Cold War, I always thought of the Cold War with the Soviet Union being much more about military. And when I look at this, you know, the increased tensions with China, I think a lot of the heart and the battleground, frankly, has been more on the economic side, if you use the term economic pretty broadly, include technology, trade, investment, finance. And what's interesting, while this is happening at the same time, many of our companies are very integrated with China. Our economies are integrated. I'm struck by recent polls of US companies in China. And when they're asked how many plan to leave China, very few plan to leave. I mean, you know, 10, 20% are thinking about maybe leaving or diversifying, but they're in China for the long term. And so, you know, it's just a very different world from, you know, the Cold War from the Soviet Union. With respect to trade, you know, in many respects, President Trump's foreign policy has been dominated by trade policy. And that's how he's related to a lot of countries, including China. So while trade was really, you know, the main friction point, along with, you know, the related technology issues, as you mentioned, Andrew, it's just interesting how trade, in a kind of crazy way, has almost become a stabilizing force or a bright spot in our relationship. And, you know, how that turned into something that, you know, looks so fraught and so damaging, into kind of a, you know, a point where there are, you know, there is some stability. I think a lot of that can be attributed to the negotiators from both sides, both Ambassador Lighthizer and from China's side, Liu He. And I would also just say that it's not just that trade's a stabilizing force, but I think the relationship between Mnuchin, Trump, and Liu He is something we're not seeing in the rest of the U.S.-China relationship. And that makes me very concerned. There are not a lot of communication channels that are open versus all the years I work for the government, where in various issues, various levels, you could always pick up the phone or work through your embassies and get access. And I think getting to what Alan was saying, and then I'm going to stop now and turn it over, you know, that's, you know, we should be concerned there. And that's something that if we're going to, you know, if we are going to step into what's called a hot war, one of the ways you avert a hot war is having very open lines of communication.
Wendy, thank you very much. And there are many issues that you raised there and many other questions that I'd like to come back and explore as we go through the session. I can see that questions are coming through on Slido as well, not least about the US presidential election. I'm sure that's something that we'll explore. But before we get there, Helen, thank you again for joining us. And I'd very much like to turn to you to get your perspective, from a slightly different perspective, from your vantage point within the financial sector, and also in terms of geography of Hong Kong. We've been hearing a lot about sort of geopolitical tensions, military tensions, technology, trade, and so on. One aspect of all of that is the threat of denying access, for example, to the US-denominated global financial infrastructure and associated measures that have been voiced as well. But let me stop there and just pass over to you on this, I guess, top theme of a new Cold War and how that's viewed. And secondly, a more focused perspective from your vantage point in the financial sector.
Thank you so much, Andrew, for your question. I think that probably from the financial sector perspective, I would say that there is a lot at stake for sure. If you look at the cross-border investment nowadays, it's not just limited to FDI. There is also substantial investment that goes through, the secondary market and also the VC and also PE market. And therefore, I'm afraid that just like what Wendy was saying, if this is a Cold War, we don't know yet, but if it is, it is a very unusual way. It is happening in a very unusual way with so many economic ties and also especially investment ties in between the two countries. So that will make it extremely challenging. And in particular, I would say that there are specific challenges in the financial sector. If, let's say, the U.S. is going to pick certain financial institution, located in China, and then limit their ability to settle or clear within U.S. dollar. If that is the case, I would say that this is potentially will be seen as a very significant punishment, and such a currency sanction would potentially bring significant consequences, not only to the financial market, but also to the global FX market, in the sense that people would see it as the beginning of a different type of world. After all, we have been living to a large extent after the Second World War in this in the current arrangement of something called the dollar standard. In other words, the dollar has been very dominant in most ways of clearing and also settlement cross-border. This is what my past advisor used to call it, kind of a dominant choice when it comes to the currency regime, which is, if you think about it, if we have 100 countries in the world and we all use our own currencies, it is actually the most efficient way to for everybody to exchange into one currency and use that to exchange to others. So you will reduce significantly the cross-currency transactions if we just go by one particular currency standard. And by almost historical accident, it was chosen to be the dollar. This is just like we go to a party. If 100 of us were all speaking a different language, we will have to use a lot of translators to translate each other. But if we are all going to translate into one language, which is just English, then it saves a lot of the trouble. So that, I think, is a potential challenge if we are seeing quite a threat in the, in this way, starting with the Chinese financial institutions being picked out. And I would say that if the U.S. Would have to give it a second thought, it will be the best, because that's probably bringing a lot of turmoil, not only to, as we just said, to the financial world, by upturning a lot of the assumptions people have been holding for a very long time. But also, I think it probably undermines the basis on which that the dollar standard has been built. So that's the first point I want to make. I also want to add one more thing, which is, coming back to what Wendy was just saying, I think it's a very important aspect that we emphasize trade. And I think that, it's a very interesting, to observe that after almost two and a half years down the road into this U.S.-China trade war, we're still seeing that actually the bilateral trade is expanding in both directions. And the trading balance still grew, right? By now, almost still by another 10% year on year. But at the same time, the investment between the two sides are increasing too. We recently published a report specifically saying that, why did China see FDI rebound so hard, right? So in July, we saw this FDI utilized in US dollar terms growing by 12.2% year on year. And in August, this number went up further to 15%. So at a time when most of the people that we talked to and a lot of us were actually sitting here actually wondering ourselves, who would want to be investing in China these days? At a time when US-China relationship is in such, is now mired with all these challenges. And at a time when, the Chinese companies has the tax sanctions, this is probably the most unlikely time for anyone to think about investing in China. But if you look at the hard number, the data is telling us a completely different story, and some of which came from the US.
Thank you. Could I just follow up on that first point? And I'd like to come back to the second point as well, perhaps by posing that question to Alan. But when you're looking at that so-called nuclear option that the US has about access to currency clearing and so on, what sort of level of risk are you or your peers, is the sector, particularly in Hong Kong, ascribing to that at the moment?
We actually have been having some scenario analysis and trying to figure out, what if that this particular undesirable choice is finally being chosen, what this implies to the financial world and what this implies to China, the US and the rest of the world. I would say that, first of all, again, this is a small probability event. We think most likely that this would be not necessarily a viable policy option in the near future, because most likely that yes, this hurts China, but it also hurts the US. And I think that, from a short-term perspective, this would bring a lot of, uncertainty to the financial world, and therefore the impact on the reputation and also the credibility of financial institutions that could be impacted, that are being concerned, would probably be very significant, quite negative. But at the same time, I would say that the such uncertainty brings questions on the dollar itself and on the U.S. financial systems and the U.S. economy as well. So that, I think, makes it a very, I would say, from a game theory perspective, a very undesirable outcome, so that hopefully the U.S. is not necessarily going to come to this in any time in the near future.
Mm. Okay, thanks. And Alan, if I could then come to you with Helen's second point there, noting, as Wendy was as well, that trade between the US and China is very strong and still growing in foreign direct investment both ways, or I think probably more US investment in China than the other way around. This is very, very different to the situation between the US and the Soviet Union. And therefore, is this actually grounds for optimism that however bad the rhetoric might get, that fundamentally these two economies are so entwined that it negates the risk of a hot war?
Yes, that's a reasonable proposition, and some people do argue that. I just make a couple of points. First of all, I did point out in the paper that I wrote for the Hinrich Foundation that the clear difference between this Cold War and the previous one is that this is essentially economic and technological rather than, well, it's geopolitical too, but if you look back to the first Cold War, because the Soviet bloc, if we can call it that, was more or less hermetically sealed from the West in terms of trade. There's very little trade between the blocs. That is clearly not the case today, so that is a big difference. I suppose my point there is that when you look at that as the key difference, but you look at the parallels, I think the parallels are overwhelmingly in favour of being a Cold War. But just moving on from that, it is true that there is an argument in the trade literature that if two countries are interdependent economically, the chances of war and conflict between them diminish. I think generally speaking, that's true, but there are notable exceptions. I'll give you one example historically. That is when Britain and Germany, just before they went to war in 1914, were closely integrated economically. In fact, trade was booming between them and they still went to war. So I think the lesson for that is you can't say that because two countries are intertwined economically, as the US and China are, that does not rule out the possibility of a hot war, because I think the risk is that both the US and China feel that the benefits of interdependence are outweighed by the risks of overdependence. And I think both countries see each other now as being too dependent on the other. That is a strategic vulnerability, and therefore some degree of separation or decoupling is necessary. And so we have this big debate now about, you know, is there going to be a major decoupling between US and Chinese economies? If so, how far will it go? Will it be just a sort of moderate separation? Will it be a full divorce scenario? And what would be the consequences for a full divorce scenario for the world, for the trading system and also for capital markets too? I think would be obviously quite disruptive and even catastrophic if that occurred. I don't think it will, but that is a risk.
And Alan, if I could just go back to that point you mentioned there about dependency, over-dependency, particularly from your vantage point in Australia. Australia's been in the crosshairs with China in recent months, barley, wine, meat exports, and so on. How is that playing out domestically, given the size of China as an export market for Australia?
Well, we say in Australia, we're caught between a rock and a hard place at the moment. We've had a very dynamic and mutually beneficial trading relationship with China for 20 years now. It's become our major trading partner by a long way. And the US, of course, is a major strategic partner and also a major source of foreign investment. So the problem for Australia is that as our relations with China have deteriorated, we're now in a sort of no-win situation either way, because it's very difficult to find a circuit breaker to reverse the downward trend in our relations with China. It just seems to be getting worse. We're also getting a lot of pressure from the Trump administration to take an even harder line on China, because that's the way the US is going. So we're caught really between the two major powers here. And what we would like is obviously to go back to the past and have a wonderful sort of the golden period where we had a wonderful relationship with the US and also China. We can't do that now. It's both relationships are under pressure for different reasons. Okay, so I think that Australia, many other countries are going to be placed in the same position as Australia. We're at a sort of like a frontier state, because we've had to actually manage the China challenge before just about any other, certainly developed state. And we've had to learn the hard way to draw a few red lines about what China can and can't do, but without jeopardising the fundamental relationship. And it's been very difficult for us to do that. I think the US is finding the same thing. and many, many other countries in the region. Just about every person I talk to in Asia, particularly, says that we are now having to make these really hard choices ourselves. We don't want to choose between the US and China, but we're finding now we're going to have to, certainly in some areas. So that's the problem for everybody.
Yeah, and very interesting, some really valuable learning from Australia and places like Japan as well about how they deal with this issue in this neighbourhood. I want to slightly change our direction and bring back Wendy to be talking a little bit about, or to go into a bit more depth and detail on trade-related issues. And I noted in the introduction that you did a lot of work on the TPP, and I wonder what you must have felt when the US decided not to move ahead with that. And now at this point in time, and particularly sort of thinking about the coming election in the States as well. Is it time for a reevaluation of TPP? Is one of those sort of pluralistic agreements a coalition of the willing? How likely is it that we're going to see an expansion of the CPTPP as it is now? And how does that play out within this relationship between US and China?
Well, before I answer that, just one point I did want to make, and that is that foreign direct investment from China coming into the US has declined dramatically in the past few years. Now, some of this was due to capital controls by China, you know, restricting the outflow of capital, but it also has a lot to do with increasing investment restrictions and scrutiny in the United States, and the expansion of our CFIUS legislation, you know, to allow a broader scope in the reviews. So while FDI to China may be increasing dramatically, in terms of Chinese FDI into the US, totally different picture. Mm-hmm. So with respect to your question, Andy, thanks for asking it, because I'm going to be publishing an Asia Society paper on a roadmap for TPP for the next administration at the end of the month. So I've looked into this issue in detail, including a lot of consultations domestically in the US, but also with our trading partners around Asia. And, you know, my view is, as someone who worked for many years on the TPP, I think it was a mistake for the United States to exit from the TPP. I mean, typically when new administrations come in, instead of just, you know, tearing agreements up, what they generally do is put them on the back burner and say, look, maybe we can improve this, we'll see, but they don't take the drastic measure of tearing up the agreements. And so that came as a surprise in the beginning of the Trump administration. Frankly, if it happened now, we probably wouldn't even blink our eyes, but it was very eye-opening on day three when Trump decided to withdraw from an agreement. And what was fascinating for me was that our trading partners, even though they knew that there was a lot of opposition domestically to TPP, they really couldn't get their hands around this, because in their view, the US got a lot of what it wanted in this agreement, and frankly was bringing the other countries in to live up to US standards in many of these areas. All that said, it wasn't a perfect agreement. My view is it's an outdated agreement now. So if the US were ever going to return, it would need to work with others to update and modernize the provisions. But I also think that the tide on trade has changed in the United States. And so the US really would need to look at what more would be needed to be added to the agreement to make it more responsive to other constituencies in the United States. But one thing, and we haven't really, I'll just pivot a little to the US political season. I would just underscore that one of the key differences, particularly with respect to China, but more broadly, is that Vice President Biden has really emphasized that he would depart from Trump's policies in terms of working with our partners and allies across a range of issues, including China, recognizing kind of that our go-it-alone approach hasn't really worked and yielded the results that the United States was seeking from China and more generally. So I think that will be one of the key differences and could play out, you know, on a range of issues, including U.S. involvement and participation and leadership in a range of international institutions where either we've been leaving or you know, like the WTO somehow weakening. I think you'll see a change there. But all that said, I think when it comes to trade, it's a very different world. And there's a lot of concerns in the United States that the trajectory we were on really needs to be reevaluated, fine-tuned, and improved, and more responsive to those that have been left behind in the United States. And that's not going away, but it doesn't mean that we can't engage and lead and enter into trade agreements. It's just going to complicate things.
Okay. Wendy, thank you. And I'd like to come back to the US election in a moment, possible scenarios there, quite a few of the questions related to that. But before we do that, I just wanted to take a bit of a closer look at China itself. And Helen, if I could come back to you again. We've heard about the sort of dual circulation of the Chinese economy and a sort of renewed focus on domestic economic growth. And I think just recently, economic forecasts for GDP growth in China for this year have been upgraded as well. I think 1.7, 1.8% or so for the year, which is quite striking given where we were at the beginning of the year as well. And I wondered if you had some sort of thought and comment looking into the Chinese economy about this idea of less of a focus on exports and more of a focus on developing that domestic economy. Of course, that's been something there for some time. But where are we in that process? And do you think this the relationships with the US, the COVID pandemic as well, are going to spur that redirection towards the Chinese domestic economy?
Thank you, Andrew. I think that those are very thoughtful questions. And I think that's probably, I should say, that's a whole set of questions that are extremely interesting. I have to peel it like an onion, one layer at a time. So let's get started by our overall view on the Chinese economy for the year. I think 2020 is a stunning year for sure, for many reasons. And actually, for now, our official forecast for real GDP on China would be 2.0%. And I would say that we're not necessarily on the more bullish side, we're on the more conservative side. If you look at a lot of our competitors, I think they have recently moved their numbers higher, especially after looking at the July and August data. The August activity growth data of fixed asset investment in the industrial production and also retail sales just came in yesterday. So the news is that it was really showing that the recovery continues. And interestingly, you know, despite the data from May, June, and July, all showing that the momentum seemed to be moderating, actually August is showing quite the opposite. The momentum seems to be picking up the steam again. And in particular, I would say that it's such broad-based growth, you know, especially from the recent past, it seems to give a lot of people the thought that maybe China not only were able to contain virus, it was also able to largely restore the economic orders to the extent that, you know, the domestic demand is indeed coming back to a much firmer footing than, you know, at a time much earlier than everybody was thinking. And therefore, everybody is looking at this upside. And a lot of the investors have been calling us in the last 48 hours, also discussing the possibility for China to tighten their domestic policy. So this may come as a very foreign idea to many of us who probably haven't been looking at the data that closely, you know, for some time, because I think the impression is that, you know, everybody seems to be still struggling a bit to come out of the blues during the COVID time. But China is already about to tighten. This is really a surprise. But when we look at it in more detail, I think it's quite striking to see that it is not just the domestic demand that is doing well. China's exports are also one of the most important drivers for this rebound. In particular, August data actually continued the trend to show that exports beat the consensus expectation, consistently for the 6 months in a row. So actually a 9.5% in US dollar terms, a 9.5% year-on-year growth in exports were mainly driven by the following. Number one is actually the COVID-19 related medical supply related demand. So the medical masks, ventilators, PPEs. The second thing is actually the work from home related demand. So that includes, for example, office supplies, electronics, chairs like this. I myself bought this new fancy ergonomic chair, footrest, as well as, for example, electronic home appliances such as bread machines. I thought people should use their oven and toaster, but you know what? Everybody is buying bread machines, where China has the market share globally at higher than 68%. So when Amazon is having this bread machine at the very top list of sales that almost quadrupled over the COVID time, China is again benefiting. So, I mean, yes, China is now saying that, you know what, let's focus on domestic circulation. This is basically another way saying that in the short term, the most likely thing that we can rely upon is actually domestic demand. They're being quite humble. In fact, the export has been growing really well. So coming back to your question about how about the strategy about separate, having the exports and also domestic demand in this dual circulation, mentioning in the Politburo meeting policy document. I think that I can say briefly what it is and what it is not. I think that in the short term, this basically means that China would have to rely much more upon domestic demand, because this is something that they can really have within their control. There is less worries about the virus situation, and there's less worries about the trade barriers. So let's focus on domestic demand. But in the long term, this is also a testament of their, of their ability to ramp up their technology so that they can be self-independent in a way that they no longer have to be choked on the neck that someone else's sanction could potentially shut their production down. So that, I think, is what they are more ambitious to do in the long term, but certainly not in the short term. And China is not necessarily trying to say, by saying that we are focusing on domestic circulation and continue to develop dual circulation, there's not saying that China is going back to autarky. So China is not trying to produce everything for everyone. But instead, I think that they need a plan B. And that's more, about in the long term, they probably need an alternative if this rivalry continues or where they continue to see such tension.
Thank you very much. And just a note on that, very interesting, because it sort of takes us back to Alan's comments at the outset. How did we find ourselves in this situation? And part of it being that strategic competition between the US and China, particularly over next generation technologies and industries, the 5G rollout and so on. And, Alan, just a quick question before we move into the questions from the audience. Have some of the policies that we've seen, particularly around technology, around 5G and so on, have they actually backfired to some extent and accelerating China's push towards self-sufficiency?
Yes, that's a good question, Andy, and there's no one has the definitive answer to that, but I'll give you my take on it. Look, when you start talking about developing sovereign capabilities, whether it's in tech or whether it's in trade, whatever that is, you want to lessen your dependence on everybody else. It sounds terrific and everybody's for it, right? Until you start to actually implement it in practice in detail. So what happened with the Trump administration? It decided to go for Huawei as the China's national champion, and also because the US decided for security reasons didn't want Huawei in their 5G system. However, what they found is that after pressure put on Huawei, Huawei having to pull out to some degree out of the US system, some of the US big tech companies started to complain to the Pentagon that this was actually hurting their business and therefore their capacity for research and development, which would then diminish national security of the United States. And so the Pentagon had to pull back a bit and look at that and think, well, maybe we need to be a bit more selective about how we do this, right? So that illustrates the broader point about decoupling. It sounds fantastic in practice if you package it up as being something we need to do for greater independence and self-sufficiency and sovereign capabilities. They're all lovely buzzwords that play to the protectionist sentiment that's now sort of ramping up around the world and the sort of recrudescence of nationalism, if you like. That plays to that sort of populist kind of rise at the moment. But when you try to implement it in a globalized world, we are still globalized, still integrated, it's very difficult to do that because you hurt yourself. So finding a way to do this cleanly and not create problems for your own economy is no one's, I think people are going to find this a lot more difficult than they think. And I think the whole 5G debate around Huawei illustrates that. It's not quite as simple and as easy as it seems.
Thank you. I'm going to jump straight into the questions from the audience that have come through on Slido. And staying with you, Alan, and Wendy, please prepare, because one of the trigger points you mentioned earlier on was South China Sea and Taiwan. And the question here, recent speculation about a possible US FTA with Taiwan. Is it credible? What would be the implications for that US-China relationship? So, Alan, maybe a first quick comment from you, and then I'll jump into Wendy.
Yeah. Well, look, you know, I think Wendy's probably more proficient in this area than I am. But what I would say is that I just want to say a couple of things about Taiwan, if I may. One, why is it likely? Why do I think it's the most worrying trigger? It's for a conflict between the US and China. It's because the US has made it clear, certainly under the Trump administration, that it will support Taiwan if it's attacked by China. Before, there was a degree of ambiguity about US policy on Taiwan. But the Trump administration has made it quite clear that they will back Taiwan and if China moves against it. From the Chinese perspective, Xi Jinping has made it quite clear that time is running out to bring about reunification of Taiwan with the mainland. In other words, he wants to do it during his lifetime. And given that he's in his late 60s, you know, you do your sums, obviously it's not some way down the track. It's actually now within the time frame of 3-5 years you can argue about this. And China has made it clear that it actually has built up sufficient military capability where it thinks it can probably do something now in a way it couldn't previously. So that's the geopolitical risk there. And that's why I think Taiwan could be the trigger for conflict in the future. Now, as to FTAs and the significance of Taiwan economically to the United States, the only point I'd like to make there is that it's quite interesting when you look at why the US would support Taiwan. From an economic and technological point of view, Taiwan is the source of the latest best chips that are the heart and nerve system of virtually everything we use these days, computers, etc. They have a foundry there that produces the best quality, smallest chips. It's the most sophisticated plant. The US does not want that to fall into China's hands, and it also wants access to that technology for the US market. So there's a really interesting tech sort of and trade dimension to the geopolitical relationship between the United States, China, and Taiwan that doesn't get much mention in conventional analyses of these. And I'd leave it to Wendy to comment on the FTA.
Thank you. And with that, Wendy, straight over to you.
Well, thanks. I think the issue of a US-Taiwan FTA has really come to the forefront for two immediate reasons. First, the longstanding bilateral pork and beef issues have been resolved, or at least Taiwan has announced that they've taken measures to address the US concerns. Politically, that kind of always stood in the way of an FTA, any consideration of an FTA. And second, I think Taiwan does see an opening now, particularly during the last days of the Trump administration, with a lot of support from Congress to try and, you know, push this through now. I think it's interesting that what you've seen, the administration has responded and talked more about strengthening and deepening U.S.-Taiwan economic relations. And as far as I can tell, it's been pretty silent about actual FTA negotiations. The State Department has announced a new economic dialogue with Taiwan, but it's interesting, USTR, I'm sure, is not going to be part of that discussion. I would just say, taking a step back from this, because I'm more and more coming to the conclusion that the days of almost big FTAs are maybe past us, and not something the United States is going to enter in lightly with any economy. And so I think what we're going to see with respect to US and Taiwan probably are more kind of focused sectoral negotiations, maybe, you know, in the semiconductor area, high tech, digital area, but other areas where we have common interests. The one issue I am watching closely is how other CPTPP countries would respond if Taiwan were to formally express its interest.
And Jeff, on that, if they did, as the UK has recently done, expressed their very clear interest to join the CPTPP, if Taiwan did, would they be able to join? How would that go down with the other CPTPP countries and Beijing? Wendy, this one to you still. Sorry.
Well, since we're not one of the CPTPP countries, I don't know if I'm the right one to answer, but I think it would be a very difficult decision. And I suspect that they will not, as a group, welcome Taiwan formally into the deal, given a lot of pressure that would be put on them by Beijing. But again, that's speculation. We're not a CPTPP country.
Okay. And Helen, if I could come to you, and slightly off the Taiwan issue, but staying on the US presidential election, I was looking at a betting site the other day, purely for research, because I'm in Singapore, and the odds are pretty close between a Biden and a Trump presidency. First of all, what is Beijing looking for in the next US president? Would they prefer the devil they know, or would they welcome a Biden presidency? And secondly, where's the smart money on that?
Well, very good question, but I'm not so sure where the smart money is betting on. So is it gonna be one-sided, or actually the smart money is already splitting it in half to on the both of the candidates? I'm not so sure. But coming back to your question, I think this is probably one of the most frequently asked questions these days, also by investors, because to the financial world, a lot of these uncertainties would arise as a result of the outcome of this particular election. But I would say that Beijing has been very hush-hush about, you know, who they prefer, what they are expecting, and, what they think that will change with or without the continuation of the current administration. I think that's probably the right thing to do, to be honest. Beijing is not necessarily the most skillful set of people out there to really understand and also interpret and explain their interpretation with skills, in the sense that, you know, they could be potentially being perceived as someone who is trying to meddle this into this situation and trying to influence the outcome. And therefore, I think this is actually a smart decision not to say much. But I do think that, personally speaking, I see both the pros and cons for both outcomes. So for example, if we're seeing a continuation of the current administration, I think clearly what the things that will help is that we kind of know where the bottom line should be, and what he prefers, what he doesn't like. And, are we even realistically thinking that the bilateral relationship could go back to somewhere when Xi and Trump were watching Beijing opera inside of the Forbidden City merely 3 years ago? I don't think so. So people have already realized that what this package comes in. And therefore, I think that that's probably the benefit of what you said, knowing your devil. But at the same time, however, I would say if there is a change in the U.S. administration, I think there is also something to look forward to. One thing is that actually there is a longer personal relationship between President Xi and also Biden. They were both serving as vice president. They go way back during the Obama and Hu time. So they actually spent some time together during the strategic dialogues, and they had a pretty good relationship by spending, such a long time with each other talking about the future of these two countries. So that, I think, is one of the reasons why people were saying, actually, Beijing might prefer Biden because they know him well. But I would say it doesn't come without a cost, right? So the concerns might be that even if a new administration may not necessarily be as harsh on the trade side, and they probably would still come back from the human rights and also Hong Kong security law and other ways to try to talk to China in a way that probably makes Beijing uncomfortable. So that, I think, would be very important to keep in mind. Beijing is probably already, aligning their expectations over who is going to be the man sitting in the White House. So at the end of the day, they understand that the strategy to contain China receives a bipartisan support, and therefore it is unrealistic for Beijing to expect that there is going to be a huge change just because of one election.
Okay, thank you very much. We're coming towards the end of the session, and I'd like to ask the panelists to turn their attention to the second part of the title, which is de-risking the Cold War. And if you could share with us one thought that you think important that we should keep in mind, that policymakers on both sides of the Pacific and elsewhere should keep in mind when we think about de-risking the Cold War. And if you could keep that very short, literally sort of 30, 40 seconds before we move into a wrap-up. And Alan, let me come to you first.
Well, I guess the key thing, the point I would make is, no matter how bad things seem at the moment, you have to look beyond the current tensions to see the way, a path forward, a way out. Because sooner or later, China and the US are going to have to reach some form of accommodation, as the Soviet Union and the United States did during the First Cold War. So what is the pathway, or what are the pathways to that? And I set out seven of them in my report. But the key one is, the US and China will have to actually sort out their issues bilaterally, but if they can't, the rest of the world's going to have to buy in to some degree through middle power diplomacy, because it's not just about the US and China, as I said before, it affects everybody. Everything we've talked about tonight, it just illustrates how systemic and widespread these issues are. The ripple effects are affecting everybody. So everybody's got a stakeholder. It's not just for the US and China to sort out. They have to make the first move, but the rest of the world has to come in and put pressure on both countries to actually, if they can't resolve their difference, at least mitigate them and reach some kind of strategic accommodation. I believe that is possible, and we eventually will get to that.
Adam, thank you. Wendy, your final thought on de-risking this relationship.
So from my point of view, we're not going back to where we were. It's a very different world that's emerged over the past few years in U.S.-China relations. But that said, I think for me, I want to come back to a theme that I made in my opening remarks. I think we need more channels of communication between the two countries at all levels and on all issues. This doesn't mean that we need to be best friends. Frankly, we're gonna be rivals. But again, I think the communication angle is really important. I think it's important for each side to understand what my boss, Kevin Rudd, will refer to as the red lines of each other. And just have a much firmer understanding of how each side can maneuver both domestically but internationally as well. But again, I think the key is, and I do think under a Biden administration, just given, you know, the vice president's extensive contacts with China over the years, but also a lot of the advisors that he has now, some probably will come into the administration, some won't. But there are, you know, very skilled diplomats with, again, channels of communication. But I just want to stress, it's not going to be, you know, going back to where we were 5 years ago in terms of, you know, having all these new dialogues and everything's great and rosy. We're not there. But even as rivals, we need to find, and I'll use Alan's word here, we need to find an accommodation. We need to figure out a way forward where we can both live in the same world together without blowing it up.
Thank you very much, Wendy. And Helen, then just a final comment from you.
Sure, thank you. I think that probably in macro, we still are talking probably more moderately about decoupling rather than a cold war for most of the time. And when we're talking about even economic decoupling, I think what we are envisaging for potential, separation could be pretty painful. So when we are looking at what exactly we're facing here, it's even going through this very tough COVID period, I have to say that I myself have been deeply impressed by how quickly US and China, these two most important growth engines of the world, quickly just go back to what they are so used to. In fact, their coexistence was almost inseparable. And if you look at the Fed printing, continue to print the money and providing liquidity for the whole world, and US consumers starting to buy as much as possible. And, the U.S. Consumption is coming back much earlier than the industrial side of the production activities, while China is doing the opposite. China is churning up as many things as possible and exporting to the rest of the world, and especially including the U.S. And Chinese consumers are slow in coming back. I'm afraid that both countries need to think about what is the middle ground on which that they can meet. And they probably both have to change a little bit of their behavior, and both in terms of policies and also their structural, spending and investment patterns. So that, I think, would probably lead to a more peaceful world somehow. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'm impinging on Alice's time. So I'm going to wrap up just to say thank you very much to all of you for your comments. And Dr. Dupont's paper is on the website, on the HeinrichFoundation.com website, where you can read the whole paper and his set of recommendations. And Wendy was referencing a paper that will be coming out, I think you mentioned, later this month on CPTPP and so on. With that, I'm going to step aside, pass over to Alice. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Andrew, and thanks our distinguished panelists, Alan, Helen, and Wendy, for your wonderful presentation. It was really great. I always feel better after hearing from the experts because you guys give me hope. And as our president has said, you certainly shed light, and there's certainly not enough heat in this world right now. And I want to, again, thank the Hinrich Foundation for helping to present this really important topic at this point in time. I think Asia Society Hong Kong was founded 30 years ago. This is a year we're celebrating our 30th anniversary. And I have to say, our forefathers would not have believed that in this day and age, Hong Kong is fighting Commerce Secretary today has said he's going to be fighting about the labeling of made in Hong Kong or made in China label that the US government has put on us. So that's something that we never thought of about 30 years ago. I think 30 years ago when Asia Society Hong Kong was established as the first Asia center of Asia Society, we had really high hopes and we continue to. So what I can't agree with Wendy enough is that we really need more channel of communication in Asia Society Hong Kong. With the cooperation and support of organization, the Hinrich Foundation, we hope to bring you more programs like this. And again, I want to thank all of our centers out there, the Global Center, as well as ASPI, Asia Society Policy Institute, headed by Kevin Rudd, for helping to make tonight's program possible. And then also do a little bit of plug. Next week, we have a wonderful program. We're going to talk about U.S., Russia, and China, from hearing from the former ambassador, U.S. ambassador to Russia, Michael McFaul, and he's going to talk about this again. We were talking about Cold War, really interesting topic, and please join us next Friday, September 25th at 10 o'clock in the morning, and we look forward to having you back. And again, our gratitude to tonight's speakers, and have a great evening, and we look forward to seeing you online at Asia Society Hong Kong, and also for all the wonderful programs coming up in the Asia Society Global Network. Check us out on Asia Society website. Thank you.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Good night.